Good morning and welcome to the first day of the second interaction that we have across all the remote centers. I'm here just briefly to formally introduce my colleague, Professor Sridhar Iyer. All of you have seen him actually through the video lectures which were put up in the first week of the FDP. He leads our effort in education technology. In fact, he is a professor of computer science, but I'm happy to tell you that he has been deputed to work full-time for 3 years in the interdisciplinary program on educational technology that IIT Bombay runs, and he will be personally leading our efforts in the coming years. I'm very happy that he is participating in this FDP and is personally present here for this interaction. He and Jayakrishnan will conduct the first session. So over to you, Professor Iyer. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Phatak. So what we will do is, we have a few items to discuss from our side. We will do that discussion. And then in the meantime, you know, if people have queries, they can send it over chat, or and subsequently we will open it for interaction. So to begin with, I think Jayakrishnan will just summarize what has happened so far, and then we'll go from there.
Good morning, everyone. So over the past, the first 4 weeks, you had done a lot of activities, and as part of the, we also had the first, during the first face-to-face interactions, we highlighted the importance of how these activities will be useful for you in the current semesters in your own teaching learning context. So let me just quickly recap the why, what and how of the first 4 weeks of activity that was that actually gave you an exposure to the effective integration of technology in your own classrooms, specifically for online and blended education. So in the first week, it was an introduction week. It was very light, and we had people, we had activities that would help you to familiarize with both the platforms, Moodle and IIT Bombay X. So in Moodle, we had the wiki activity of course portfolio, where we saw that participants came in, they made edits to pages, they created their own page, they wrote their own teaching learning mission statement, etc. And in general, you explored the IIT Bombay X platforms through the demo course. And also, you are, some of you are familiar with Moodle. So you saw some submissions happening in the Moodle, like the entry survey and et cetera. In the second week, we actually started with the core aspect, that is flip classroom, the idea of flip classroom. There were videos which were called learning dialogues. We call them learning dialogue videos that familiarized you with the concept of flip classroom, the why, what and how. There were LBD activities or practice activities aimed at reinforcing whatever you saw in the video. And there was a discussion forum set up so that you could collaborate, you could discuss about various aspects of flip classroom. Specifically, there was this active learning strategy, think, pair, share, that could be utilized in a general classroom, be it a flipped one or face-to-face. So it is applicable for a face-to-face classroom also. And you had attempted the first resource creation submission, which was actually a think, pair, share activity for your classroom. After the face-to-face interaction where we explained the various features, we also talked about how this is becomes more meaningful, how it becomes more effective. The next week, we focused on screencast creation. That means you were exposed to the technology during the face-to-face interaction. And in the subsequent week, you actually created an activity, a screencast activity for your own course. This was followed by a in-class activity for the screencast. So actually, we created an entire flip classroom activity through resource creation assignments 2 and 3. And you had been exposed to both the technology of screencast as well as the pedagogy, the active learning pedagogies that could be utilized in doing the in-class activity. Now, across all 3 weeks, we had employed a method called peer assessment, such that which is aimed at improving the collaboration, providing learners with more detailed and descriptive feedbacks, and generating a sense of community ownership for all the activities that you do as part of this workshop. The learning platforms, IIT Bombay X and Moodle, also had discussion forums. The discussion forums primarily focused in IIT Bombay X. So we had just collected some statistics of the discussion forums for till day before yesterday. And it is seen that there are nearly 2,500 threads that were created in the discussion forum, which and also had nearly 9,500 discussions over the past 5 weeks. So I have a list of people who are the top contributors in this discussion forum. I'll just read out their names. So the top performer is Jagpal. He has nearly 235 contributions in the discussion forum. It includes both threads and posts. There is a user, Kusuma Jana, who has 85 posts. Then there is Utpal Das, who has 80 posts. Jatin Ambasana, 79. And Payal Dande with 77. So if you look at the second, third, fourth, and fifth, they are very close. And mind you, there are even a lot more. In the top 20, the closeness is very, so it's like by one post or two post difference that separates the top 20 performers. So it is actually a very good evidence that people are making use of these platforms. They are trying to, many of these queries were actually answering some of other participants' queries regarding technology or different aspects of the assignments. So they have not just posted queries, they have also helped other participants, which is very crucial while looking at collaboration. And peer assessment was one such form of collaborative activity which was aimed at building the community. So we'll be talking about peer assessment in detail pretty soon, but this is just to give you a recap of what we have done across the past 4 weeks and what we saw as evidence from the platforms about what is happening in the course.
Okay, so what we will do now is address two questions. One is about, you know, what can you get out of this course, you know, why this course and all that. And another one is about the peer assessment itself. So coming to, you know, what can you get out of this course, you know, there have been many people who have said that, look, all this technology is fine, but it's not available in our college, or, you know, we don't have support and so on and so forth. Okay, so now the thing to remember here is that, like, students have moved on from being 20th century learners to 21st century learners. And it is now well known that for students, the important skills in 21st century is the skill of being able to, you know, critically think, assimilate information, to be able to collaborate, and to be able to communicate their ideas. These are some of the key skills that are required for students to function effectively in the 21st century. So as teachers, we also need to keep up. So if you think about what was important in the 20th century, okay, in the 20th century, we did not have so much access to internet. In fact, that started only after 1985 and so on. And there was no access to, you know, textbooks, especially, you know, we had to depend upon Eastern Economy editions and things like that. So what was really crucial in the 20th century was information. And teachers were the key purveyors of this information. So anybody who had attended talks or who had access to the information or who had access to books and journals, they were valued at a premium because that information was not accessible to everyone. So if you had the information, And if you had the ability to communicate that information effectively, you were considered to be a good teacher in the 20th century. So in the 21st century, however, that's no longer true. Everybody has access to the information. In fact, while you are conducting a class, it's possible that a lot of students will be, you know, checking online immediately about, you know, what you're saying, what are the counterpoints to the points that you're making, and so on. So the access to information is no longer a problem. So what is important now as teachers is for us to be able to help students to develop these skills of critical thinking, of collaboration, and being able to, you know, evaluate and synthesize information into what is useful for them. Okay, so one of the reasons for this FDP is that while you may not be able to implement all of these techniques in your classroom, no, we are not expecting that 100% of you will be able to implement 100% of all the techniques that are being taught. Okay, but however, what is important is to have the awareness. So there is a there are formal models. One of them is called the technology integration matrix, okay, which has various stages that a teacher goes through in integrating technology into their teaching learning process. Okay, the first step here is awareness. You know, you have to first be aware that such technologies exist, and irrespective of whether you can use them in your class today or not, this awareness is what contributes towards your becoming more effective. The second step is to develop some appreciation for the technology or what it can do, you know, to be able to critically evaluate, okay, when will this technology be useful in my class, when I should use it, when I need not use it, and so on. Okay, so awareness is the first step, then appreciation is the second step. Then comes adoption. Okay, it's only in the third step that you actually adopt the technology. The technology now here can be a ICT-based technology, or it can simply be a classroom-based technology, which is a pedagogy, basically. So all of these things, the whole idea is that once you develop the awareness and the appreciation, that is when it will be possible to adopt them in the classroom. Okay, so if a large number of you, now all of you would have reached the awareness stage. So the way we have designed this program is through a principle called immersivity, wherein you are, instead of simply telling you about these things, we have actually made you experience them as a learner, and we have made you create such activities for the learners in your class. So that is the steps that we are taking to say that, okay, after awareness, we can do appreciation because you have actually engaged in such an activity, and then you go to adoption, wherein you create such activities for your students. So even if you are not able to implement all the activities that you create, there is no need to feel that, you know, this is just for somebody else, it's not useful for me. The awareness and the appreciation will go a long way, and maybe a couple of years down the line, a lot of these will become possible to implement on a routine basis in many classrooms. So that is one of the things that I wanted to kind of emphasize in this today's interaction. The other point that I wanted to emphasize is the point about collaboration. So just like I have been saying that it's students need to develop the skill of collaboration, we as teachers also need to develop the skill of collaboration. Okay, so now this happens in multiple ways, two of which we are adopting in this course. Okay, so one way is the collaborative resource creation. So that is what Jayakrishnan was saying some time back, where we will be having community resources which will be created, and these resources collaboratively created by all of us becomes a global resource for any of us to use in our classrooms. So now one important thing of getting this resource created at a fairly high quality level is the peer assessment. Okay, so now what we have seen is that some people have taken the peer assessment seriously, both in terms of submitting the assignment as well as in terms of giving feedback to their peers. Okay, whereas others have kind of just done it because it is part of the requirement and so on. Okay, so what I would like to mention here is peer assessment is not just a duty that we perform. Okay, it's not simply because we have set it up and, you know, we don't have the TAs to go through all the assignments and give feedback. So there are two things that happen during peer assessment. Okay, one is you are giving useful feedback to your peer. Okay, so that feedback is definitely useful. But what do you get out of it? Why should you bother? Let the peer worry about their submission themselves. Why should you take the trouble? So the answer to that is that when you take the trouble to go through what your peers have done, your learning also improves. Okay, so this is a strategy that we have used even in undergraduate classrooms. We have had students evaluate each other's papers. Okay, and what happens, the feedback invariably has been, is that I have learned something by seeing the other person's answer. Okay, so either I have learned something new, or I have got a new idea, or I have learned what should be done, and so on. Okay, so students invariably in the beginning, they always feel that this peer assessment is a chore and it's not something to be done seriously. But then once they get the hang of it, they realize that a lot of learning happens during the assessment itself. So that is one difference between this FDP and others that you may have undergone. In many courses, the purpose of assessment is to grade, is to award a grade to the learner. Okay, whereas in our course, the purpose of assessment is also learning. The purpose of assessment is not grading, but the purpose of assessment is learning. So when you are assessing your peer, the more seriously you look at the submission made by the peer, and the more critically you evaluate it based on the rubrics that are given, the more your own learning increases, and your feedback also becomes useful to the person whose submission you are evaluating. So their learning also increases. So peer assessment, don't think of peer assessment as an evaluation technique by which somebody is given some marks. Peer assessment is actually a learning technique by which both the person who has submitted and the person who has assessed or who is assessing, both of them get to learn something in the process. And this is known to be a effective way of learning, rather than the instructor simply, you know, giving feedback or TAs looking at it and giving feedback. So that is the reason why we have so much emphasis on peer assessment in this course, and why we need you to take the peer assessment phase fairly seriously. So with that, I think we don't have anything more to say from our end. So we will go into the interaction phase. So if there are, if anybody has questions, please feel free to do a hand raise.
So just in case, so towards the end of the interaction, we'll be detailing out the marking schemes. So we have received a lot of queries. So some of the commonly asked questions, how does peer assessment is, how I have had problems with peer assessment. So one part of it has already been addressed right now. The other major query is regarding the grading mechanisms for the first component, that is the effectiveness, the pedagogy of integrating ICT in classrooms. We'll be detailing it out shortly towards the end of this session. All of you are aware of the grading policies. So the first 4 weeks will be constituting 40% or 40 marks to say. So we'll be detailing this towards the end of this session, where I'll give you an example case. And I hope, so if there are those kind of questions, please put it on hold. Ask only the relevant questions, which will be more useful for the community. D.Y. Patil, Pimpri.
Sir, it was nice what you had briefed, looking over the 4 weeks scenario, as well as what Dr. Iyer has briefed about the peer assessment. I just want to say, when I too was doing this peer assessment and was thinking of implementing in the class, as Dr. Iyer has mentioned, it is very true, half of the chunk takes it very seriously, whereas half of the crowd does it as if it is a process to complete it. So can we do something wherein for this peer assessment itself as something like a think pair share assessment, which is, for example, right now we are assessing 4 assessments. Every participant is doing 4 peer assessment. Later on we can put just like nesting, 1-to-1 pair, and finally the sharing of the comments. I think if it works, really it will do for everyone a serious task.
Yes, that's a good idea. We can have multiple rounds of peer assessment. So right now what we are doing is, since we are in the first stage, we are just having one round of peer assessment. But what you are saying is that we could have multiple people also assess the same thing and give feedback. However, it is important to remember that it is not possible to get everybody to do it with the same level of seriousness. I mean, the amount of, regimentation that we will have to put in will actually defeat the purpose. So we will have to depend upon people's inherent sincerity in order to carry this out effectively.
Yes, sir. Thanks for that. But my concern was in the class wherein we have to involve amongst the student and to see that every student is brought to a level of sincerity in that case. That was my concern actually.
Yeah, so that every student is something that which is a goal which is not attainable, because there will always be students in your class who are not interested, who will play the game and so on. So, you know, if the general thumb rule in teaching learning is that if 80% of your students are doing 80% of the work that you have asked them to do, you are doing a good job as a teacher. So that's a, you know, more meaningful target to shoot for. And yes, there will be people who will try to game the system. There really is not much that, you know, you don't want to spend too much energy on trying to prevent that from happening.
Thank you, sir.
LDRP Institute.
We have discussed this think, pair, share technique, this active learning technique in detail. So apart from TPS, there are other active learning strategies like peer instructions and group discussions. So TPS is used only for theoretical topics. So for specialized numerical types of questions or topics, which kind of active learning strategies can we use?
Okay. So there are two parts to this. One is TPS is used only for theoretical topics. Actually, that is not entirely correct, because TPS can be used for also numerical types of topics. For example, I use it very routinely in a programming course, which is not theoretical. So TPS is useful in a wide range of topics. And as you get more and more confident with implementing the technique, you will find that you are able to use it in many, many ways. See, the reason why we are introducing TPS and peer instruction as the two main techniques is that these are easy to implement. There is very low overhead for you to actually carry it out in your classroom. The other techniques, there are a lot of other techniques like, you know, what you mentioned, group discussion, then there is team pair solo, then there is role play, then there is, you know, web quest, and a lot of other techniques are there. Those get a little bit more cumbersome to implement, and many of what you can achieve by that, you can achieve by these two simple techniques also. So for example, let us say you have to do some mathematical derivation or something. You know, even if you can set that up also as a peer in TPS activity by giving one step as the think phase and asking students to do the subsequent steps in the pair phase. And in the share phase, as the instructor, you simply summarize how the proof of a certain theorem is supposed to work out. So depending upon the question and depending upon, you know, how much practice you have had to execute the strategy is very powerful and can be used for, you know, non-theoretical topics also.
1107, Purnima College.
The question is regarding RC3 assessment. Hmm. Now we are supposed to do this assessment. So whatever assessment that I have seen here, is that the faculties have not considered that what is to be done in the 1 hour period of the lecture. What they have submitted in the assignment is that for 20 minutes these activities would be done, and 25 minutes, maybe maximum 30-35 minutes. What about the rest of the time?
Yeah.
So because a lecture is comprising of minimum 50 minutes. So 10 minutes I can understand attendance and classes going on a bit late, that is fine. But what about the rest of the time? So I have commented on a lot of assessments that please consider the complete lecture time. The activities are not complete for 1 hour. So is this right? Because I have reduced marks at times because of this.
Okay.
Is it right, or what should be done?
Okay. So let me rephrase this question so that everyone will be able to listen. So the question is that typically in RC3 assignments in class activity, the total duration of the activities provided in the in class segment was generally for less than 1 hour. So typically most of you will be familiar with a 1 hour lecture, and yes, active learning strategies may constitute only 20 to 30 minutes inside it. So what should be done for assessing these kind of submissions? Generally, the assessment strategies, the rubric that has been provided, it is just to check whether they have employed active learning strategy. So I would recommend that if they have provided a good active learning strategy and sufficient justification of why this strategy is active, you should not reduce the marks. But yes, what you did is correct.
supposing somebody has given only for 20 minutes, you should provide it in the detailed comment that whatever activity that you have provided, it is only for 20 minutes duration, and there is another 40 minutes of lecture or 30 minutes of lecture that needs to be also thought of. So this comment is a valid one. Please do not reduce marks. So supposing you have reduced marks, please go ahead and reassess the person, because we don't want any. So the rubrics are general guidelines on these activities. And why we haven't focused too much on the 1 hour schedule is because we wanted them to integrate some active learning strategies as part of their lesson design. So it's exposing you to the, or making you adopt active learning strategies in the classroom. So that is why the marks are there for active learning strategies. But yes, you should comment that this is not complete, you need more time. And if you look at the example submission, each of the example submission was for 1 hour. So the first example submission had 3 active learning strategies. It had peer instruction, it had team pair solo, it had think pair share. Whereas the second one had only one or two active learning strategies, but still it had time allotted for 1 hour. So this is an important thing that needs to be focused while doing a lesson design. The entire lecture has to be focused.
Sardar Patel Institute.
Yeah, so I have like two queries. First thing is that in peer assessment, we are getting feedback from the people, but can we implement any other mechanism where we can even give feedback on feedback? So then it will be like, you know, like some kind of like a value of their feedback, because we have seen that in most of the people, they are not even looking at the assignment and then just giving some random kind of like comments. So sometimes it is like a very demotivating. And another thing that I want to suggest is that, I mean, maybe from your TAs or something, like 2-3 maybe expert in that particular can be appointed as a like observer in this particular process. So is it possible to implement this mechanism?
So both of these are good ideas. You know, one way in which you can give feedback on feedback is to be simply able to say, you know, to what extent you agree with the feedback and to what extent that feedback was useful to you. You know, so a simple rating of the feedback is possible. I don't know to what extent our system will be able to, you know, implement this right away.
So yeah.
And the second thing about, you know, expert TAs at our end evaluating, so a little bit of that is possible, but it cannot be done on a large scale simply because of numbers. You know, we don't have that many number of TAs. And so what we will see is to what extent it is possible for you to rate the feedback that is given to you. I think that is a good suggestion. We will try to see whether it is possible for you to say, you know, I strongly agree with the feedback, this feedback was useful to me or not. And in that way, we can at least know who are the people who are giving useful feedback and or not.
Yeah. So just to answer based on technology, yes, current Moodle peer assessment has this drawback that you are not able to give feedback on feedback. So that is why we have a separate feedback about the peer assessment process. So where we have asked you how detailed did you give feedback, how many reviews did you get, how helpful were the feedbacks, the peer feedbacks to you. And we generally asked an open-ended question on about your own feelings about the peer assessment process. So that is one mechanism through which we have implemented the feedback on feedback. The other TAs, as Professor Iyer noted, the massiveness, the scale and the diversity, both are some issues if we were to target monitoring or other kind of activities. One implicit goal of this workshop is that the community themselves will be moderators themselves. So that is why this peer assessment process is kept in, and there are a lot of incentives for collaboration, good collaboration or effective collaboration practices throughout this FDP.
In addition to that, can I add one more thing in that? I was about to say that thing. I mean, at least like whomsoever has submitted their submission, they should given some chance to reassess on all the feedback and give some kind of like a review on that thing. So at least we can know whether the participants are really satisfied or not.
Yes. So so after the first 4 weeks, we can open those assignments back in the assessment phase. And if people do want to reassess, they can go ahead and do a reassessment for those submissions. That is possible. That is possible.
Okay. So my colleague wants to speak to something. Yeah. This question is related to the cognitive levels. Now I am representing a polytechnic. I'm a faculty member from a polytechnic. So it is generally understood that while teaching in the polytechnic, the students are required to reach the apply level, the recall, understanding, and the apply level. And normally we do not go beyond that. The analysis level, recall, I mean, evaluation level, and the creative level. Because they say the students are supposed to be trained to be the supervisors at the middle level. So do we have to make some modifications in our TPS activity when we are doing the flipped classroom? Outside the classroom, when we are doing, can we say we have to do at the understand and the recall level, and then in the classroom, in class activity, can we do at the apply level and limit it there? Should we go beyond that? Can we make a little modification? That's my question.
So the short answer is yes. You can feel free to modify the TPS activity based on your local scenario, because you are the expert on the topic that is being taught and you know what your students need. Okay. However, it's also important to keep in mind that the analyze and evaluate levels are useful for everybody. So for example, even if they are only going to build something, it's not just the apply level, because at some point, they may have to do some troubleshooting, they may have to do some activities of that nature, which will require application and analysis both together. So it's always a good thing to train your students to do something a little bit more than what they are expected to do. All right. There is one more question, it looks like.
Yeah, so my question is related to the CBM marking technique, which was introduced when we were shared the Moodle videos. My problem is that I have not clearly understood the marking technique, and I want to know whether C1 to C3, there is something like set mark for it, that is 1, 2, 3, or can a teacher change it according to her discretion?
I believe you are talking about the rubrics, the markings of the rubric. So the question is about the marking scheme of the rubric. So if you look at the marking schemes, the leftmost is a least productive example, and the rightmost is the target performance that we are looking at it. So for the purpose of this particular FDP, we have used a marking scheme that the lowest one will be, the missing category will be 0, and the target performance will be 3. So it's just one mark difference. It is just a quantitative setting. If you want to actually use it in your own course, like you want to use peer assessment using Moodle in your own course, yes, the teachers have the flexibility to provide marks. You can provide sufficient marks for each of these categories.
Okay. And since the explanation given for certainty based marking was not very clear in the video, can you provide some additional material for us to go through, or another video by which we can understand this scheme properly?
Sure.
Because it seems that it is important, as you know, one of the very important questions of the quiz is also based on the CBM marking scheme.
Sure, sure.
So that's a request from my side.
Sure. So
thank you, sir.
So we'll be posting this up in the subsequent weeks.
Okay, we'll move on to another center now. Dronacharya College of Engineering.
Sir, my name is Jagpal. On the discussion forum on IIT Bombay X, I posted a thread. It was basically related to the common mistakes people do in pasting the hyperlink on the assignments or activity. I'm just going to suggest one thing. Let us understand the importance of pasting link, because pasting the link from slide on the address bar is a very time consuming. I mean, why not to make this particular link as a workable, which can be clicked and to that go to the YouTube. Okay. That is not happening in most of the cases. This can be found out because I assigned and assessed 49 assessments. Out of 49, only 4 assessments could have proper link on this. That includes me. So I can say that 45 people out of 4,400 people are actually doing that mistakes. And the thread was mistakes in pasting URL on the activity. So kindly take this matter up, and because nobody has responded till date, including the staff at IIT Bombay.
Yeah.
Just wanted to is this is a very small mistake, but important to understand how we are going to paste the documents and between the other. So kindly take up this and give proper sense and can take it to that. Thank you.
Sure. So thank you, Jagpal, for the suggestion. Yes, we will implement this. Maybe we'll add this on to the constructors. Every constructor documents that we are building, we will provide essential guides on how to do this control C, control V effectively. So it's just copy pasting. Okay. So yes, we will do this. Thank you.
Okay. Central University of Rajasthan.
Sir, there is a simple query. I have uploaded, I have given feedback on different activity uploaded by peers. For example, there is a written that 4 activity has to be submitted, but I have did 13 activity at the scheduled time. In my feedback page, there is a cross written mention that you have this much number is remaining. I want to clarify whether 4 was so have to complete those all evaluation peer review.
Yes.
This is a simple query.
So only 4 is sufficient. That cross is because it is a Moodle setting. So Moodle has assigned you 40 or 50 assignments, but we have asked you to do only 4. So we will be taking care of that at the back end, and we will be making necessary adjustments to see that. So do not worry about the cross mark. We will that is a system setting.
So Vishwesvaraya National Institute.
Yeah. In peer assessment, I got feedback which was mostly ritualistic. And so when someone gave me very poor score, I couldn't understand my weaknesses. And when someone scored me highly, I couldn't learn about my strengths. But out of all these feedbacks, I got one very constructive feedback, and I would really love to be in touch with that person. But is there any way in which I can seek the contact details of that person? Of course, provided that the other person is willing.
Yeah, so you understand the predicament that we have. So one mechanism that you can provide that has been already provided is the IIT Bombay X has a discussion forum specifically for community building. So based on your domain, we have provided a mechanism where this has been promoted. What additionally we can do is we can create a discussion forum where specifically where peers want to discuss feedbacks or want to build upon the feedbacks. So it is only building upon the feedbacks. We won't promote any fights or quarrels because of the poor feedbacks. So only for those construct people who want to engage with other reviewers, we can set up this discussion forum. We'll first check its feasibility. If people are taking it up, we will definitely put it up in the next week, in the upcoming weeks, because this FDP is going to last for another 4 weeks. So somewhere around 3rd or 4th week from now, we can set this community up.
See, generally this review process is supposed to be anonymous, you know, at all levels, you know, including when you submit a paper to a conference, the same thing happens. That some feedback you get, somebody gives you high marks without telling you why, somebody gives you low marks without telling you why. And there are one or two people whom you feel that, okay, if I talk to this person, I will get more information, it will be very useful. So the one suggestion, but it's difficult for the, you know, conference organizers or the course conductors to actually disclose this anonymity. But what you could do from your side is you could say that, look, the person who posted this review comment, you can take a snippet out of the review comment and you can say, okay, you know, on the discussion forum, you can say that, look, I was very happy with this review comment. I would like to contact you. The person who posted this review comment, can you please get in touch with me? And then you just have to leave it to the other person, depending on whether they want to, you know, engage further or not. And if somebody responds, then you know who the person is and so on. But from the, you know, institutionally, there is nothing, because this anonymity is fairly sacrosanct in a review process.
Currently, in Moodle, we have set up non-anonymity only for, so it's a single blind review for Moodle. So the reviewers know whom they are assessing. So supposing somebody gave you a constructive feedback, they definitely know that you are one person who have provided a decent job, who did a good job. So let us hope that they will message you through Moodle and get in touch with you. So there is a messaging mechanism in Moodle, and there is also this discussion forum where you can actually get connected with each other.
Good morning, sir. So my question is regarding the out of the class activity where we have to create screencast videos. The point which I felt that the problem between the screencast video and the teaching in class in on board, the difference is that while we teach in the class on the board, it is very easy to describe them any numerical problems or solutions step by step. The problem which is felt in the screencast video is that if there is any derivation or is there any derivation of any equation, I can't tell them in a subsequent way, in a proper manner, in a PPT. The problem which I faced in that, the use of tool which we see in electronic pen and the board, that would have been much helpful in this case. And furthermore, I have seen that in order to create, as you have told that, in order to create an out of the class screencast video, the length must be short, within 10 minutes. That will make them, that will make the students interested in the video. The point is, if we want to create a video in 10 minutes and I want to deliver maximum of the concept, then the video must be very much interactive. The point is that in order to create a video very much interactive, it is not just we can do alone. That there must be an the editing, there must be video editing, there must be background animations, and something post processing of the video must be done. So that requires manpower. Just not alone a faculty can make an interactive screencast video of 10 minutes that will give an efficient, that will deliver an efficient concept to the students. So I think that if we want to implement the out of the class activity much more, then there must be an increase of the manpower regarding the post processing of the screencast videos.
Okay. Yes. So at a broad level, yes, you're right that if we want to create this, it is going to take effort. So it takes effort on the part of the faculty also too, because you have to now change the style of talking, and you can't talk the way you would normally talk in the classroom, and it's useful to have some other post-processing to make the video effective. However, what we have to keep in mind is that what you are creating screencast is not for a purely online course. You know, it's only when you are going to do a purely online course, we need that level of fidelity in the video itself. Since you are going to augment this with an in-class activity, the right now let us just have the goal of doing basic information transmission in the screencast video, so that the background material which the students are supposed to know before they come to class, that material is covered. So what you are saying, all of it is valid if we want the student to learn mostly through the screencast itself, whereas here what you are attempting is to make the student learn some part through the screencast, the background material, and then when they come and do the in-class activities in your presence, that is when the maximum part of the learning is happening. So this exercise of having a post-production team which will create the video and all, now that it depends upon whether it is available, whether the resources are available. They cannot be made available centrally. So depending upon that, you can decide to what extent. So it is, it's a challenge for the instructor to decide, what to do in the screencast, which is effective at the same time, which is not very time consuming for them.
So the detailing that we must deliver in the screencast video means the details, the amount of details that we need to deliver. So it shouldn't be that so much in details, because there will be an overall summary. And then in the class, we will do the detailing of that topics.
Yes, so generally that's a good idea, in the sense that you introduce the topic in the screencast video and you create activities which will help the student to do the detailing. See, the idea is that you should reduce the amount of work that you do in the class on the board. Okay, so whatever you would have done on the board, some of it goes into the screencast. and some of it goes as activities where the students who have watched the screencast, they come and derive the subsequent steps and you are there facilitating the process of their learning. So you're right. Okay, National Institute of Technology.
I would like to ask this question.
Yeah.
What do you think about TPS outside the classroom?
Okay, it's a valid question. There are mechanisms, so people have adopted different technologies to use think-pair-share outside classrooms. For example, wikis have been used, where there are individual pages, there is a collaborative page, and finally the entire thing is visible as a common edited page. Somebody have used Google Drive to do this process. There are also, what do you say, other technology tools like Padlet, etc., which facilitate these kind of online, outside the classroom and online, purely online mode of think-pair-share. So yes, it is doable, but make sure that there is some kind of moderation that you are doing. So you don't want everybody to post random thoughts. So some guidance. So be it a in-class TPS or outside class TPS, the TPS has to be very carefully designed and implemented by the instructor.
See, also, sort of in a lighter vein, that TPS will anyway happen outside class. Okay, because before the exam, your students are anyway going to be talking to each other, they are going to be, you know, discussing and all of that. So what the important focus for you is to make sure that it happens in class also. You know, so what we want to do is effectively utilize the time. See, you are the resource, and that resource should be available to the student for doing, you know, higher cognitive level activities. When they are doing higher cognitive level activities, that is the time when they need your presence. So in the class, the more number of such activities you organize and, you know, you're able to execute, the more beneficial it will be to the students. Outside of the class, you know, you could go ahead and do all the online TPS activities, but that will anyway happen, you know, around, because students will talk to each other, especially, you know, just before the exams. That's a fairly natural process that happens.
Sir, actually, I'm not pointing out that. I am talking about the structured TPS outside the classroom, not the informal way. Informal way is different. I mean, they do, they think, they share, prepare, that's fine. But the structured way of doing think, pair, share activity outside the classroom is, I think it is needed. And as another sir pointed out, I mean, it is not necessary, I mean, that's my opinion, necessary to have it online, to have the TPS activity outside the classroom. You can even have that offline mode, but the structure, what we do it in TP and S, it should be such that we can even have it as a TPS outside the classroom. That gives more time. I mean, we can have it inside the classroom, that's fine, but outside the classroom, we can give that spare time and all. We can give more time for doing something more deep, I mean, to the higher cognitive level analysis. So that's what my opinion. What do you think about this?
Yes, it is valid. Again, what you said is correct. So doing it in a structured way, just ensure that as an instructor, your presence is also present in the out of the class, because generally all these activities, as Professor Iyer told you right now, the students should also feel that the instructor support is also present. That is what they get inside the class. So if this some amount of it is also present outside the class, there is no harm in it.
See, in a TPS activity, the instructor has two important roles. First role is in structuring, setting up of the activity. Now, what will happen in the think phase, what will happen in the pair phase, and so on. Okay. So if the instructor does not do a proper job there, then the TPS will fail. So if the instructor has done a proper job in the think phase and the pair phase, these two perhaps can happen outside the classroom. However, the instructor also has a major role to play in the share phase. So if the share phase is going to happen outside the classroom, the instructor has to figure out a way to be present during the share phase. Okay, so ideally, you know, even if you want to do TPS out of class, what I would recommend is that you can let the think phase and the pair phase happen out of class, but the share phase, you must have, you know, your presence is necessary during the share phase in order to, you know, summarize, in order to, you know, clarify common errors that are being made and so on. Okay. There seems to be one more question at the center. Yeah.
Like with a peer assessment process, as you rightly said, some of them are doing it seriously and some of them are not doing it. I had an assessment wherein there were two people sharing the same video. So how do we assess such people? What would be the peer assessment for such people? Like the videos were the same, exactly the same. And the topic was also the same.
Okay. Typically this might be we wanted individual works to come in resource creation assignments just because we wanted to expose you. If there are cases like this, typically this is a case of plagiarized content which is strictly forbidden in this particular FDP. We even had all of you submit a ethical statement agreeing that I won't do such practices. And if there are some sharing of ideas, it will be acknowledged. So Professor Fatak is going to detail about the policy against plagiarism tomorrow. So please hold on to your queries till then.
Sir, I have a question. We are asked to upload our screencasted video in YouTube. Also, we are selecting the option called Creative Commons License. Who is monitoring this process and who is giving this sort of license to us? Can you brief something about Creative Commons License and the YouTube Standard License?
Okay, Creative Commons is actually an organization which was a reaction to, you know, standard copyright rules. So it's just like that copyright is very extreme in the sense that others cannot use your copyright at all. On the other hand, you know, in teaching learning, often instructors feel that they want to share their material with other instructors. Now, the question that came up was, you know, how to share without losing any of your own rights. Okay, you don't want to give something out into the open and later on somebody else claim that completely as their own because you didn't attach any license to it. So Creative Commons is kind of a response to that in the sense that it has various levels of license. At the lowest level, it's called Creative Commons by attribution. By attribution means that your name will always have to be carried forward whenever anybody uses your work or makes a derivative work from yours. And there are also more restrictive versions or more like, for example, Creative Commons, attribution, non-commercial, share alike, and so on. So what we feel is that in the educational space, it is sufficient to go with a Creative Commons attribution license. If somebody is going to take your video and, you know, make money out of it, the people who are, you know, students of that video are eventually going to come back to you because you are the originator of such a video. So Creative Commons attribution is often sufficient, is simply to safeguard you, saying that, okay, you are the first person who created that video. And it's not as restrictive as copyright, saying that where the other person cannot do anything with the video. That is the idea behind Creative Commons. Okay, Krishna Institute of Engineering.
Yes, sir. Sir, if someone has missed RC3, so if there is a grading policy that we need to complete all the assessments.
Okay. I'll just generalize this. So the question is, somebody has missed an assignment. So the question is specifically about RC3 submission, and the grading policy says that all assignments are mandatory. So there is we have already defined an alternate mechanism for it. It is the course portfolio page. We have asked each and every one of you to submit whatever work you have done as part of this FDP in your own course portfolio page in Wiki. Now, the policy is that the due dates are non-negotiable. So the assessment of these will not be possible. So typically you get 0 marks for this submission, but it will also ensure that you are eligible for the certificate. It will make you eligible for certification if you post it in the course portfolio page.
Problem is that we can submit it on the course portfolio.
Exactly.
But so, the assessment will not be assessed.
No, the submissions will not be assessed. So whatever is the submission, we'll just see whether you have submitted all the relevant submissions for the FDP. These will not be assessed. This is just to ensure that you have created all those activities. But again, these will be checked for plagiarism, and if we find plagiarism, the action for the plagiarism will be detailed by Professor Fatak tomorrow.
BRCM College of Engineering.
Okay, my question is that initially, when we are assessing our fields, it's a kind of learning. How learning is possible while we are evaluating our fields?
Okay, I think the question, I didn't catch it fully, but the question was how learning is possible while we are evaluating our peers, yes. Right? So, like I mentioned sometime in the beginning, there are two types of learning that is happening. One is the feedback that you get from others. Okay, so that is, that's like the standard evaluation where you get marks from the teacher and you know, you get comments from the teacher about what you can improve. The other one is when you are the teacher, and when you are the evaluator. So what happens is that since you are also in the same domain and you are also teaching similar topics, this peer assessment, the learning that happens is, you know, you get a lot of ideas, you know. So you get ideas on, okay, I can do a TPS like this also. I can modify some activity in this manner. I can create a screencast in this manner. So these are the kind of ideas that you get when you are looking at other people's submissions.
And also you are always cross-checking somebody's submissions with a detailed rubric which has characteristics of target performance. So you always evaluate the submission against this target performance and this becomes a learning for you.
My question is regarding the grading part. You are giving more grades to the quiz. Quiz is something which is theoretically based, whereas when we write assignments, it is something that is based on our creativity and, you know, evaluation process. Somehow, I personally feel that assessment criteria should be changed, where quizzes can be considered at theoretical level and be graded in a much better way.
Okay, the point is taken that assessments can improve, but yes, we are addressing the question. So we have three mechanisms of assessments in this particular first 4 weeks. First were the knowledge quizzes, which actually looked at the theoretical concepts that you learnt. Then there was a reflection quiz, which was about the participation that happened in the discussion forum. So did you go and check the discussion forum so as to encourage what is happening within the community? And the third one, the resource creation assessment, is actually about the creativity. The rubrics, it is very open-ended, and we have actually tried to address it through rubrics. So rubrics give some details and there is some subjectivity in assessment, and we have provided it as peer assessment practice.
So let me take a couple of queries which are there in the chat window. There is one query from Sardar Patel Institute of Technology, Andheri, which says, you know, we generally use Bloom's taxonomy, but the Kolb's model is advanced compared to Bloom's taxonomy. Is the Kolb's model difficult to implement? So actually there are many models. It's not just Bloom's and Kolb's are just two of them. And you know, we have picked Bloom's taxonomy because it is very widely used and it is sufficient for our purposes. So that is the main reason that we are going with the, you know, revised Bloom's taxonomy. You are free to implement any other model also as per, you know, what works well for your class. Okay, so there is a questions tab which says some of our participants are not able to submit the RCs.
Okay, this is again, so people who are not able to submit any assignment, make sure that you submit it as part of the course portfolio. Unfortunately, we won't be able to assess or evaluate them, but it will ensure that you have provided all submissions as mandated in the grading policy.
There are a couple of more such questions, like a couple of participants have missed the first week of the face-to-face session. Are they eligible to attend the rest of the sessions and complete the course?
So, participants who have missed face-to-face sessions, so be it the first one or the current one, please make sure that you send out an detailed email to e-outreach team who are coordinating with this in this workshop, and get the feedback from them. So they will be providing you details on what to do and what happens in case you have missed a session. So typically these face-to-face sessions are for interactions, not just interaction with the instructor, but interaction among your RCs. So make sure that the interaction happens, and we have the videos of these face-to-face interaction sessions uploaded in the IIT Bombay X platform. So make you go through it and do all the activities that are there in those sessions.
Okay, going back to the interaction, Pulla Reddy College.
Sir, good morning, sir. My question is regarding peer assessment activity. In the peer assessment list, in my sub-list, some of the activities are listed which are not belongs to my domain, like mathematics, physics, etc.
Yeah, so as far as possible, we have tried to ensure that participants from the same domain get submissions from the others through the group choice. So it may have happened that the people who have submitted wrong submissions, they would have selected a wrong group to join in. So that might be the reason, that is why you are getting this. So one possible way to ensure that they get, if you have do not have sufficient assessment and you are forced to do these assessments, then kindly take the help of the community who are from this particular domain, either in your college or through the IIT Bombay X platform. Get in touch with people who are in this particular domains to check for the validity of the submissions. I would advise you, if you have more assessments with you, so typically you have 16-17 assignments per resource creation. So as far as possible, try to stick to your domain so that you can give an honest feedback about the activities.
Okay, Marathwada Institute of Technology.
My question is, whatever we are learning now, it is just offline without student, and actually in when semester will start, we want to implement these in our classes. So when we want to go for out of class activity, whether we have to give a constructor or in other forms to the students to work these activities.
So the purpose of the constructor is to help you to create the activity. So you don't have to give the constructor to the students, you just have to create the activity and ask them to carry it out. So students need not be shown any constructors or any rubrics or anything. They have to just simply do the activities that you have created for them. So they have to watch the out of class video, they have to come in class, they have to do the TPS or the peer instruction, whatever is the activity. The constructor is merely an aid for you to create the activity. There is no need to ask students to create such activities. Okay, NMIMS.
Good morning, sir. I am from RC1103. My question is, theoretical subject where the exam is focused on the lower cognitive skills such as apply, understand and recall, how to justify the higher cognitive skills activities of evaluate, analyze and create?
So it depends upon where the exam is. You know, if you have some control on the internal assessment, that is where you can utilize this. See, the main thing is that students have to understand the benefit of these higher cognitive level activities. So that if you are able to communicate to the students, then irrespective of whether it is there in the exam or it is not there in the exam, they will still cooperate with you. But if you don't have any control over the exam, and if it is just organized by somebody else and they are all full of recall, understand level questions, then there is really not much you can do about it.
Okay, we'll be taking the final two questions because the session is about to end, and then we'll also discuss about the grading strategy for the first 4 weeks. So we'll explain the marking schemes. So RC1082, Hindustan Institute of Technology and Management.
Yeah, sir, this is related to resource creation assignment 2. When I am seeing the performance of that, like in assess peers, it was asked that we should do minimum 4 assessment, and where I have done 6 assessments, but still there is a red cross and I am not able to understand that why the red cross is there, and I have submitted the assignment before deadline.
Okay. So this is a common query. Every person in the Moodle would be seeing a red cross in the assessment phase. This is only a setting in Moodle. So it just says that you haven't assessed all the assessments that were given to you. But at the back end, we are ensuring that we have given you the advice that you have to assess only 4. So if you are submitting 4, please do not worry about the red cross that comes in the assessment phase. It is perfectly valid. But if you are not, we are checking that at the back end. So do not worry about the red cross.
Yes, sir. Second question is that in the resource creation assignment 3, again I am having the same query that it was asked to review four assessments and where 24 were given. And I did four, but there the dotted line is there. It's not a complete line that which is which will ensure me that I have completed the required task. No, so why is the dotted line though I have completed four assessments?
So the dotted line is because you have not assessed the 24 of them. So Moodle sees that you were given a bucket of 24. In the bucket you are given 24 and you have taken only four out of it. So Moodle does not clearly understand that these were mandated by the workshop team that you need to do only four. Now this is a small Moodle bug which the other team is trying to, so as I have already told, this assigning of more is perfectly valid because it gives you more exposure, but you have to do only four. Please do not worry about the settings that are coming in the Moodle page, because if you have done four reviews, we will be using only that for the grading.
Okay, so I have third question that when I look after my grades, there in FC activities, I had submitted resource creation assessment 3 submission and resource creation assessment 3 assessment phase also. But the grades have come before the submission and before the assessment phase, and that is not like the grade is not 5 out of 5 like that. So is it under still under process? The grades are still under calculation, or that is somehow I have missed, somehow it has been missed to grade my resource creation assignment 3 or resource creation and assessment 3?
So resource creation assignment 3, the grading is still in process. The assessment phase will be completed only tomorrow. Tomorrow night is the due date for it. The grading will happen only after that. So please do not worry about if you are seeing these scores till tomorrow. Day after tomorrow, whatever grade you see, that will be the final grades for the submission and assessment. We'll be taking the last interaction. This is RC1347, Mahindra Engineering College, Namakkal.
Yes, sir. I want to convey some information regarding assignment submission. Sir, we are very much interested in session creation for using screen castomatic. It is very interested, and creativity of the faculties are improved now. Thanks for this session. But one thing I want to convey my feedback is, while giving assignments, why an alert message can be given to the faculties? When we have completed the first assignment, RC assignment 1, coming for RC assignment 2, we came to know on Friday 20th only, but when we start our submission, it is getting dead. We cannot able to submit our assignment in time, as well as we cannot able to access the resources. Any solution for this one?
Okay.
It will affect our grade or not?
Yeah. So the due dates and every release. So every releases at the time of release itself, we have been saying that so and so is the due date. The assessment will open at this particular point of time. So if you look at it, all the contents are released on Mondays and the assessments are released on Thursdays. So if there are some technical flaws, we release it on Friday and provide you one additional day to do the submission. So this has already happened across the past 4 weeks. And we have been giving you sufficient time for submissions. So if people who have not submitted the assignments, it is really unfortunate. But one possible way that you will be still be able to participate in the FDP is ensure that all your submissions are there in the course portfolio page. And this, the due date is the 29th of June. So you have one full month to work on it, work on the assessment, supposing that you have not done it. Upload it in the wiki, course portfolio page, your own page, and ensure that you can still be part of the FDP certification policy.
Yeah. All right. So it's just 2 minutes left before the start of the next session. So we'll have to wind up here. And I still see some hand raises and, you know, some queries on chat. What we will do is, you know, you can send your queries, continue to send your queries by chat, and we will compile all of them and post one consolidated set of answers later on in the discussion forum.
Just one minor addition. Please note that the first 4 weeks of this FDP, it constitutes 40% or 40 marks. The split up is provided. Knowledge quiz, we take 60% of that. Then there is a reflection quiz, we take 20% of that. And there is also a small the resource creation assignment, that is the peer assessment process, we take 20% of that. And there is some amount of 1 mark for the wiki and the lab assignments of the previous interactions. So if you carefully look at the grading policy, we have provided how this is going to be calculated. So each of the marks that you obtain for the grade, that is the for peer assessment, it is the grade that you see in the activity. So there will be a grade for your submission, and there is a grade also for the assessment. So both of these will be added, and that is calculated towards resource creation assignment 3. So I hope, please do read the grading policy in detail. We'll be posting a detailed example in the discussion forum on how the grading policy is going to work out. So thank you everyone. Please keep participating in the discussion forums, and let there be more collaboration among each and every one of you. Thank you.